Mr. President, ahead of tomorrow's hearing in the Foreign Relations Committee with Secretaries Kerry, Moniz, and Liu on the President's announced nuclear deal with Iran, I wanted to take a few minutes to address just how far the administration has moved its own goalposts in terms of this purported deal. Over the last few years, the administration has made extensive public statements about what would and would not be acceptable in a final deal with Iran. And today, it's clear that the final deal falls short not necessarily of other people's expectations, but of their own standards and their own stated expectations. So as senators consider this proposed deal and whether it should be approved or disapproved, I think it's important to have a good understanding of where the President and his team did not meet their own expectations. From the early stages of the negotiation, the Obama administration made clear that a key part of any, quote, good deal would be dismantling Iran's nuclear infrastructure. Before the House Foreign Affairs Committee, Secretary Kerry noted back in December of 2013, he said, the whole point of the sanctions regime was to help Iran dismantle its nuclear program. However, President Obama, in previewing the deal in April of this year, essentially admitted that it would fall short of this standard, saying Iran's not simply going to dismantle its program because we demand that it do so. But weren't our negotiators actually demanding that Iran dismantle its nuclear program? That had been our stated policy as the United States government. Wasn't that, in Secretary Kerry's own words, the whole point? So as Prime Minister Netanyahu of Israel pointed out, instead of dismantling the nuclear infrastructure of Iran, the number one state sponsor of international terrorism and threat to the safety and stability of the Middle East, this deal legitimizes, it paves the way for their nuclear program and its enrichment capability. In fact, by the time this deal expires, the rogue regime in Tehran will have an industrial-sized nuclear program. For the duration of the agreement, Iran will be able to conduct research and development on several types of advanced centrifuges. In the year 8, Iran can resume testing its most advanced centrifuges, and in year 9, it can start manufacturing more of them. That is hardly dismantlement. That is the opposite of dismantlement. So I also want to address another important point that's been made concerning inspections, because as we know, Iran will cheat, and so inspections take on an especially important role in enforcing any agreement that is made. And in particular, I want to address this issue of anytime, anywhere inspections. In April, President Obama announced that a good deal had been struck between world powers and Iran and noted that the deal would, quote, prevent it from obtaining a nuclear weapon. This is, of course, now known as the framework deal, a precursor to what was announced last week. A few weeks after this announcement, Secretary Ernest Moniz, the energy secretary, who was at the table with Secretary Kerry in negotiating this deal, he said, we expect to have any time, anywhere, or I should say anywhere, anytime access. He said that on April the 20th, 2015. This is a particularly clear statement from someone intimately familiar with the negotiations process. And of course, it was well received because this is, at minimum, what needs to be done in order to keep Iran from cheating. But by the weekend, the administration was singing a different tune. This is what Secretary Kerry said when he began to backtrack from what was said by Secretary Moniz on April the 20th. He said, anytime, anywhere, anytime inspections was, quote, a term that honestly I never heard in the 4 years we were negotiating. It was not on the table. I don't know whether Secretary Moniz and Secretary Kerry actually talked to each other or not. They spent an awful lot of time together in Vienna and supposedly would be on the same page. But for Secretary Kerry to say this really incredible statement that this he'd never heard of this idea and this was not on the table is just simply incredible. So, of course, my question is, were anywhere, anytime inspections ever on the table? And if not, why did the administration tell us they were, including the Secretary of Energy? And if they were not on the table, why is this deal actually a good deal? Why can we have any sense of conviction or belief that Iran won't cheat, especially given this Rube Goldberg sort of contraption involving notice and this bureaucratic process that will basically lead up to a 24-day delay between inspections are requested before inspections actually can be done. We know from our experience with Saddam Hussein in Iraq that it's easy to move things around and avoid the inspectors at the IAEA. So this deal today provides that inspectors will have, quote, managed access, whatever that means, to suspect sites. But as I said, it allows up to 24 days for Iran to stall inspectors before it actually grants them access, if they ever do. This is another way of saying that Iran will be able to cheat with near impunity. The administration has also led us astray, Mr. President, on a third item, and that is Iran's ballistic missile capability. This is the vehicle by which Iran could launch a nuclear weapon to hit people in the region or even further. In February of last year, the chief U.S. negotiator, Wendy Sherman, testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee that while Iran had, quote, not shut down all of their production of any ballistic missile, the issue was, and she said, quote, indeed going to be part of something that has to be addressed as part of the comprehensive agreement. Ballistic missiles, as we know, can be used to deliver a nuclear weapon. And now under the current deal, the arms embargo on Iran will be completely lifted in just 8 years' time, including on ballistic missiles. I don't think the administration simply changed their minds and decided that this wasn't an important issue. I think they simply caved on yet another important item to our national security and that of our allies. Earlier this month, for example, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Martin Dempsey, testified that, quote, under no circumstances should the United States relieve pressure on Iran relative to ballistic missile capabilities and arms trafficking. So with this purported deal that the administration apparently has caved once again on something that the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, who is a number one military advisor to the President of the United States, said should be off the table. Under this negotiation, apparently it is on the table and part of the deal that we will have an opportunity to vote on in September. One more example. The President has repeatedly said that from the beginning, no deal is better than a bad deal. And I agree with that. And yet right now, he and the rest of the administration are telling members of Congress and the American people that there is no other option on the table, and it's either this deal or war. There is a third choice, Mr. President. There are tougher sanctions that will bring Iran to the table for a better deal and a good deal. It's simply unacceptable for the President to be misrepresenting what the options are to Congress and the American people by saying it's either this deal or war. As bad as this deal is, obviously no one wants war. But we do know that Iran is an existential threat to our number one ally in the Middle East, the nation of Israel. And Iran has been engaged in proxy wars against the United States and its allies since at least the early 80s, since the early days of the current regime. Well, the President is supposed to be Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces and the number one person in the United States government when it comes to national security. He took office with a promise to restore America's relationship with our allies around the world, and clearly his promise has not come true. Instead, what the president has delivered during his time in office has been that our allies increasingly do not trust us, and our adversaries no longer fear us, as evidenced by the coercion and intimidation engaged in by Mr. Putin in Eastern Europe. Mr. President, I'd ask unanimous consent for two more minutes.
Without objection.
Even President Carter, President Jimmy Carter, in a recent interview admitted that the United States' influence and prestige and respect in the world is probably lower now than it was 6 or 7 years ago. This isn't some Republican criticizing a Democrat president. This is Jimmy Carter, former president of the United States and a member of the Democratic Party, who's saying the United States' influence and prestige and respect in the world is probably lower now than it was 6 or 7 years ago. This is a difficult statement to take in, and President Carter has been wrong about an awful lot of national security issues, but I'm afraid he's right on that one. So now Congress has an important role to play, and I can't think of a single more important national security issue we will have an opportunity to act on than Iran's aspirations for a nuclear weapon. This is a true game changer in terms of the stability and peace in the Middle East and our own safety and security. And I know that I and the rest of our colleagues will take full advantage of this opportunity given to us for 60 days to review this agreement, to put it under a microscope, and we will have no trouble voting it down if we conclude, as many of us are now starting to do, that it jeopardizes American security and paves the way for a nuclear-armed Iran.